Hello, everybody. Welcome to Connections. I know, surprise, surprise, surprise. You might be thinking, Phil, what are you doing live online after noon on Sunday? Well, in the message today where we were at, the signal just kept messing up several times. And I was encouraged by my wife and others to redo this message today. I had people say that the message blessed them and it helped them and it was good for them. And so they said, please redo it. So I am re-teaching this morning's message. Now, my wife's not here to type in all of the information, so I will endeavor to tell you the Bible references where we're going to be reading a couple times and give you a moment or two to get there. So we've already had 62 people endeavor to watch this morning, but like I said, the signal was really, really bad. So we're going to try this again. So here I am in my office, and we'll do this again and try to get this information, this message out without any interruption, and believe God that a couple people will log on and watch us. Hallelujah. So Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for wisdom and revelation, and thank you for this opportunity I have to minister to these, your precious people, and the opportunity to reteach this message again. We give you thanks, Father, for opening your eyes to see wonderful things from your word. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Hallelujah. Well, let's open our Bibles to Genesis chapter 21. I want to talk to you about living his life. That's the title of the message, Living His Life. We're going to read in Genesis chapter 21. We'll read verses 25 through 32. This is a great story here with Abraham. So I'll give you a moment there. Genesis chapter 21, verses 25 through 32. Hallelujah. Are you ready? Praise God. Let's read the scriptures. And Abraham reproved Abimelech because of a well of water, which Abimelech's servant had violently taken away. And Abimelech said, I wot not who have done this thing. Neither didst thou tell me, neither yet heard I of it, but today. And Abraham took sheep and oxen and gave them unto Abimelech, and both of them made a covenant. So what did they do? They made a covenant. Abraham and Abimelech made a covenant. And Abraham set 7 ewe lambs of the flock by themselves. And Abimelech said unto Abraham, what mean these 7 ewe lambs which thou hast set by themselves? And he said, for these 7 ewe lambs shalt thou take of my hand, that they may be a witness unto me that I have digged this well. Wherefore he called the place Beersheba, I'm going to read verse 31 again. Wherefore he called that place Beersheba, because there they swear, both of them. Thus they made a covenant at Beersheba. Then Abimelech rose up and Phicol, the chief captain of his host, and they returned into the land of the Philistines. So I want you to notice this phrase where Abimelech says to Abraham, what mean these 7 ewe lambs? Why are you taking these little lambs and setting them aside? Now, Abraham knew something that was really important. He knew that as those lambs grew and multiplied, so would Abimelech's awareness of his covenant with Abraham. You see, Abraham gave him something that was alive, something that would eat and move around and make noise and multiply and grow. Abraham did not give him a stick or a stone or a diamond. He gave him something living that was a part, it was a testimony, it was a witness of the covenant between them. So let me say this again now. Abraham knew that as those lambs grew and multiplied, so would Abimelech's awareness of his covenant with Abraham. God designed that covenant consciousness would grow in your life until it takes over every thought, every word, and every deed. Covenant is a life that is lived. And I want to say all that again. I think that is so important. God designed that covenant consciousness would grow in your life until it takes over every thought, every word, every deed. And covenant, This is a statement God gave me some time ago. Covenant is a life that is lived. It's not just something on paper that we recognize on occasion. When we enter into covenant with God, it is a life that is lived. Okay? So our awareness that we have a covenant with God should be growing. Just like when Abraham gave these little lambs to Abimelech, they would grow, they would make noise, they would move. All right, it was going to be a witness, and Abimelech would say, wow, well, I had seven, now there's 15, and a little bit later on there's 30, and then there's 45. So these lambs would grow, and Abimelech would be overcome by an awareness. He would live in a consciousness that he had a covenant with Abraham. I think that's wonderful and that's powerful. So keep in mind that what Abraham did with Abimelech, he gave him something that was alive, something living that would grow, that would multiply. Okay, as you keep that in mind, go with me please to John chapter 15. John 15. Now, this is a famous passage of scripture for many Christians. Many of you will have this marked in your Bible. This is an awesome teaching of our Lord Jesus. John chapter 15, verses 1 through 5. And as we read this, think now, keep in mind about covenant and life, something living, something growing, something developing. The Lord had me up late last night. I woke up in the middle of the night, couldn't sleep, so I got up, went in the other room and read my Bible. And the Lord ministered and added something because I was thinking about this morning and teaching this message. And one of the things the Lord added to that was not only was this these lambs alive and moving around and making noise, not only would they multiply, but Abimelech would have to tend. He would have to attend to those lambs. And the Lord spoke this to me last night. He said, that's the way it is with the covenant. As your awareness that you have a covenant with me, as that grows, you're going to be attentive. You're going to be more and more attentive, and you'll need to attend that awareness. You'll need to tend to the covenant. All right? There is a scripture. This is the latest scripture God gave me concerning covenant that I want to share with you. You don't have to turn there. Just listen to this. This is Psalm 74 and verse 20. Have respect unto the covenant, for the dark places of the earth are full of the habitations of cruelty. Have respect unto the covenant. Well, as Abimelech tended to those sheep, as he watched over them, fed them, took care of them, he was having respect for the covenant that was between him and Abraham. And as covenant awareness grows in us, we need to be sure that we have respect unto the covenant that we have with God. In John 15, verse 1, Jesus said, I am the true vine. Now, what would that imply? Jesus says, I am the true vine. That would imply that there's many false vines out there. Amen. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. What's the husbandman's job? To inspect the fruit. That's not your job or my job. That's the Father's job. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. We'll stop right there. Fruit has life in it. And it has life in it because it came from life. Don't let that be too simple for you, okay? I know that's grade school, kindergarten stuff, but I want you to stop and think about that for a moment. Fruit has life in it because it came from life. The life of God will develop you. When you made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, God came into you by his Spirit, and God imparted his life and his Spirit into us. So the life of God was given to you that it might develop you. Those little lambs had life in them. They were going to grow. They were going to develop. and Abimelech's awareness of his covenant with Abraham would grow. Jesus says, I'm the vine, you're the branch, abide in me and I in you. The life force that's in Jesus is meant to flow through us so we can bear fruit. I think this is exciting, man. Hallelujah. So the life of God will, can, and will develop you. Now, in contrast, the law cannot develop you. The law, the Ten Commandments, cannot develop you. But God's life, once again, can and will develop you. The law has no life in it. And this is one of the things that God was sad about and why he brought in a new covenant. This is a big reason why the law was temporary, is because the law had no life in it. What I'm saying to you is this. The law could point its finger at you and say, thou shalt not lie, but the law didn't have any life in it to impart to you so you could keep the commandments. All it could do is tell you, better do this, better do that, don't do this, don't do that. Thou shalt, not. It would tell you what's right or wrong, but there was no life or power in the law to empower you to live it. And so because there was no life or power in people to live it, and they sinned, they became guilty. They became sin conscious. They became aware that they had fallen short time and time again. Okay? So the law could not bring life. But Jesus, according to John 10:10, Jesus said, I am come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. So this is why Jesus came. He came to do what the law could never do. He came to give us the life of God. Put that life in us so it would develop us. Praise God. That's just awesome. That's outstanding to my way of thinking. Let's read over in Galatians chapter 5. Galatians 5, 22. And just say out loud, the life of God. The life of God, the life of God. Galatians 5, 22. We'll read verses 22 and 23. Hallelujah. There's Mrs. Rucan. Hello there, sister. Glory to God. Mrs. Rucan's watching. Hallelujah. That's awesome. Galatians 5, 22. But the fruit of the Spirit. The what? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. There is no law against the fruit of the Spirit. Once again, I get excited teaching this stuff. This is just absolutely wonderful to me. When one has the life of God in their spirit, producing the fruit of the Spirit, who needs an outward law to regulate your conduct? Because when you learn to yield to the life of God, and the life of God is manifesting this fruit in you, you don't need an outward law to tell you what you should do and shouldn't do. In fact, it's a higher life, it's a higher way of living than what the law could ever give you. The law couldn't really give you much. It was temporary. So when one yields to the life of God, the life of the Spirit, and it's producing the fruit of the Spirit, you don't need an outward law to tell you what you can and cannot do. Now, check out this statement. The fruit of the Spirit is the life of God in manifestation. The fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, just go through the list. All of those, that's the life of God in manifestation. Or we could say it like this. When the life of God manifests in your life, it's going to manifest as the fruit of love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. When we yield to that life, this is what's going to happen in our life. We're going to have this fruit in us. It's going to be evident to ourselves and to others as well. And you're going to be nice. People are going to want to hang out with you. They're going to want to spend time with you, because you have all of these things that the world is so desperately needing and missing. All right, so we got life in the lambs, this covenant between Abraham and Abimelech. Jesus said, abide in me and I in you, and you'll bear fruit, you'll bear much fruit. There's the life of God. Here, Galatians 5, 22, 23, the fruit of the Spirit is the life of God manifesting through these different fruit, okay? Now, with all of that in mind, go with me to Colossians chapter 2 and verse 10. This is this verse. If we can get a hold of this verse, our life would so dramatically change in so many ways. This is such a powerful, powerful truth. Now, I grew up in a Pentecostal church. I have an awesome pastor. He loves God. It was a great church. But there were some things we just didn't know, some things we didn't have revelation on. We just didn't see it. And if we had just known this verse, if we had just known Colossians 2:10 says, "And ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power." Did you get it? And ye are complete in him. We are to live from a place of completeness in Jesus. Not try and attain a place by our own self-effort. How many of us, our prayer life, that's what it is, our fasting, our praying, our going to church, we're trying to attain a place in God. And the Bible says here that we're made complete in Jesus. God wants us to shift our thinking and stop trying to reach for something when we're already complete in him. This would take care of inferiority complex, all the jealousy and the envy, and if we would live our life knowing that we're complete in Jesus, that when we were born again, his life and nature came inside our spirit. We're complete in him. And as we yield to that life and the fruit of the Spirit's manifested, as we're in the Word and our minds renewed, I'm telling you, there is no stopping us. And this is what God wants for us, to live from this place of completeness. Why are we complete in Jesus? Because of his life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I got to say it again. We are to live from a place of completeness in Jesus, not try and attain a place by our own self-effort. 90-something percent of all religion is right there. It's giving you the tools and how to do all this stuff so you can get to this place in God that you want to be. You're already there. In him, you're complete. Ephesians chapter 2 says that we're seated with Christ in heavenly places. Brothers and sisters, we don't know it, but we've already arrived. Not in ourselves, but in Jesus because of what he's done. Oh, that's hard on the flesh because we want to work for it. We want to pray for it. We want to fast for it. We want to not watch TV for 3 weeks to try and get something. But we don't have to try to get something that Jesus already bought and paid for. All we have to do is acknowledge it and realize he's living on the inside of us. That, my friend, is the good news, and that's wonderful. I'm so thankful for Jesus and what he's done for us. Let's go back to the book of John, please. Gospel of John, one more time. We are in John 15. Let's go back to John chapter 6. John 6:47. We're going to read a few words here, a few verses. Praise God. I'm thankful that we have the life of God on the inside of us producing this fruit, that we're complete. I'm blessed. John 6:47. Are you there? I hope you are. John 6:47. Jesus speaking once again, he says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath," H-A-T-H, that's past tense, "hath everlasting life. I am that bread of life. Your fathers did eat manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven, that a man may eat thereof and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world." The Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" Then Jesus said unto them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye have no life in you. Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life. And I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father hath sent me, and as I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. Awesome passage. It begins with Jesus saying, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. Believers in the Lord, we have something. We're not going to get this. We already have it. We have something. What do believers have? We possess the life of God. We are partakers of God's divine nature. I keep going over this in my mind. I've thought about this so many times, and I keep coming back to this truth. The same Spirit, the same life, the same power that God used to raise Jesus from the dead is living on the inside of me. It's living on the inside of every Christian. If you are born again, not a sub-spirit, not a second spirit, the same life, the same power that God the Father used to raise Jesus is living on the inside of you and I. Hallelujah. The life of God that is in you is greater than the law and is greater than any circumstance you could ever face. This is a covenant of life. It's a covenant of God's life. This covenant of life is what it's just what we're meant to live by. we're meant to live by the life of God and not try to do things on our own initiative and by our own ability. The fruit of the Spirit is the life of God in manifestation. Recognize that life. Recognize it. Yield to it and let it flow through you. God never intended for you to live the Christian life by your own ability. He intended for you to live the Christian life by his ability, by his life and Spirit. Hallelujah. Jesus came to give us life. We are to live by the life of God. Now, we're getting close to closing here. Just a few more verses of Scripture. Let's read in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. That's really a lot to take in, to realize that God's life, his Spirit, his nature is on the inside of us. When we get this, if I could get a group of people, myself included, could really get a hold of the life of God and realize that the life of God is inside of us, we could live to be 120 with little to no sickness or disease. It would just be a foreign thing for us to have any colds, flus, headaches, hay fever. I mean, just no heart disease, no liver problems, no back problems, no Parkinson's, no. I mean, just when we come to understand that the life of Jesus, can you picture Jesus with the flu? Well, of course not. Can you picture him with boys? Oh, I can't go preach the Sermon on the Mount today. My allergies are acting up. We cannot picture Jesus sick. We shouldn't be able to picture ourselves sick because his life is in us. And once we really renew our minds and yield to the life of God, sickness and disease will be a thing of the past. We can go for decades. I know that's not what's taught. I understand that. I know that that's strange to many people's ears, but I'm telling you, it's Bible. Paul wrote in Corinthians about the life of God being manifest in our body. I'll let you look that up for yourself. You can do your own homework. But think about it. The life of God's already in your spirit. As we renew our mind, which is in our soul to it, and we yield to that life, it's going to manifest through our body. Hallelujah. We're teaching our granddaughter, our little granddaughter, 6, her name's Serenity Ann, and we're teaching her, and Leanne wrote this confession, and we're teaching her how to confess her faith. And one of the lines in there I love so much is this: my body is a sickness-killing machine. Amen. My body is a sickness-killing machine. Why? The life of God is manifesting in our body. Praise the Lord. That's what Jesus came to give us, was his life, and that more abundantly. Well, if you have the life of God in abundance, you can just wave goodbye to hay fever, colds, flus, and all that stuff. And I'm not saying you'll never die. That's not true. The Bible teaches us we'll die. but you don't have to go senile, losing your mind, being frail. I keep telling people, when I'm 95, I'm going to be riding my bike, waving at people. And they're going to say, what's the secret to your success? And I'm going to say with a big smile, Jesus. Jesus, he gave me his life. Praise God. 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 23. I know there's a lot of sickness and disease in the world. I understand that. But the life of God is greater. Verse 23. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be partaker thereof with you. When you study your Bible, one of the things I like to do is I like to find truth, obviously. I like to pull out nuggets. But an added bonus is when you come across scriptures like this where the people who wrote the Bible, when you find out what was in their heart, what was their motivation. And this verse reveals to us the heart of the Apostle Paul. This is what motivated him. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be partaker thereof with you. You can know the history of the Bible and not know how to stand on it and not know how to make it work for you. And there are a lot of people that know the history of the Bible. That's one of my favorite subjects I like to study on. I've got a shelf here behind me that's got just full of books on how we got our Bible. That's something I study on. I don't teach on it a lot. But just between the Lord and I really enjoy studying on it. It builds my faith in the Word of God that we truly have a perfect Bible. And so I enjoy studying that out. And there are people that can tell you, and they're full of Bible trivia, and they can tell you how many steps Jesus walked on this day, and how many miles it is from here to here, and what the weather was like. But when it comes to something attacking you, they don't have a clue to how to use the Bible to overcome and live in victory. You can know the history of the Bible and not know how to stand on it and make it work for you. Paul says, I do this that I might be a partaker of the gospel. When you act on behalf of the covenant will act on your behalf. Something God gave me a couple of days ago. I really appreciate him giving me that. When you act on behalf of the covenant will act on your behalf. We're going to read in Hebrews chapter 8, just two more verses and we'll be finished today. Hebrews chapter 8. Is an outline of the new covenant. Hebrews 8, verse 10 through 13. This is one of my favorite passages of scripture in this area for today. People who know me know what I'm talking about. Hallelujah. But seriously, this is a wonderful, exciting passage. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10 through 13. This is wonderful. Hallelujah. I run out of words to say. I told a friend of mine last week, I said, I think I live in a perpetual state of excitement where the Word of God is concerned. It's just so real to me, and I love it so much. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for all shall know me from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. And that he saith, A new covenant he hath made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. Notice every part of this is just teeming, it's just overflowing with the life of God. He says here in verse 10, I will put my laws into their mind. He's not talking necessarily the Ten Commandments. Think about the law of faith, the law of love, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made us free from the law of sin and death. He's going to put the law of faith in you. He's going to put the law of love and the law of the Spirit of life. Isn't that interesting? The law of the Spirit of life. He's going to put his laws into our mind. He's going to write them in our heart. He will be our God, will be his people. Life, life, and life. We're not going to need to teach everybody, know the Lord, because all's going to know me from the least to the greatest. There's life. I'll be merciful to their unrighteousness. There's life. I'll forgive them. I'll be merciful to their iniquities. I'll forgive them. I'll remember their sins no more. Life. Life. we have a covenant with God of life. There's a scripture, I believe it's in Isaiah, that says that your covenant with death will be annulled. Sinners, people who have never made Jesus Christ their Lord, have a covenant with death. But those of us who believe in Jesus, have let him come into our heart, we have a covenant of life. And it's the life of God that he wants us to have and to have more abundantly. Praise God. So every part of this new covenant speaks of the life of God. Wonderful. Thank you, Jesus. Our last scripture for today is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Now, 1 Corinthians 11 is the passage I usually use when leading the congregation in communion. A lot of times when I take communion here alone in my office, I'll use this passage. Sometimes I use others or a combination. But I usually, this is a pretty standard foundational passage for me. And I had a wonderful time Friday night. I went to a pastor friend's church, and he was reading this passage. And just as he read it, I got revelation. It just like jumped off the page. And then he spoke at the same time the Spirit of God was speaking it to me. And I want to share with you how to be a partaker of the life of God. How to overcome sickness, disease, lack, frustration, depression, discouragement, whatever your trouble is, I want to show you how to get the life of God working for you. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23. Are ye interested? Amen. Amen. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. What did he do? He took bread. What do we read in John there about the bread of heaven? When he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. He told them, he said, you got to eat my flesh, you got to drink my blood, or you'll have no life. But if you eat my flesh, if you drink my blood, you'll have life in you. And now here's one of those applications. Here's how we feed on the life of God, is by taking what we call communion or the Lord's Supper. Verse 26, for as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. And that phrase just really popped out, stood out at me, and the Spirit of God spoke this to me and made this real to me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Now, when you study covenant, and most American Christians, when we think of Calvary, we think of death. But the Hebrews, and rightfully so, the way they see it is at Calvary's where he poured out his life. Yes, his death was involved, but it was in his dying that his life was poured out. Okay? You do show the Lord's death until he comes. So here's the deal. You take the communion elements, you take that cracker and that blood, and you read this passage. What's troubling you? Okay? Show his death to what's troubling you. Take Satan to Calvary. Take sickness to the cross. Take fear to the cross. Take depression to the cross. Take loneliness to the cross. And so you have the cup, you have the bread, and you say, let's say depression. Depression, I'm showing you the Lord's death. What are you doing? You're declaring, I'm the redeemed of the Lord. I've been redeemed from you, depression. I'm free from you because of what Jesus did at that cross. When he died, he poured out his life and gave it to me in abundance. Depression, you have no power over the life of God. I'm showing you his death till he comes. Glory to God. If you have the flu, you got a fever, get those communion elements. Fever, I'm talking to you in the name of Jesus. Look at this. Look at this. Look at his body. Look at his blood. His body was broken. His blood was shed This is his death. Look at it. You're defeated. Death, you're defeated. Sickness, you're defeated. I have the life of God. I've been redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Psalm 103, verse 2 says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom God has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. I'm free from you. I don't have to be sick. I don't have to be discouraged. I don't have to be going out of my mind. Don't ever make jokes about losing your mind. That's a very sad thing. If you've ever seen somebody lose their mind, it's not good. It's sad. Don't ever make any more jokes about losing your mind. No, you want the life of God in you, flowing through you, keeping you bright, sharp, and alert. Amen. The Bible tells us in the book of Deuteronomy, God says, I've set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. So we get to choose, but we can choose the life of God. And we can take Satan to Calvary. We can take him to the cross. Anything troubling you, you can be a partaker of God's life and nature. And on purpose, take your trouble to the cross. Show your trouble the Lord's death, and you receive the life of God. Hallelujah. We are involved in a covenant of life. God's life, his spirit, his nature is living on the inside of us. We are coming from a place of victory. We're not just going to victory. We're already completing him. We're coming from a place of victory. Praise God. It's time to just rejoice and celebrate that Jesus has defeated death, hell, and the grave. He's defeated COVID-19. He's defeated the flu. Satan's already been judged. And we, his people, have his life in us. Glory to God. Living his life, that's the high life. That's the best life, is learning to live his life. Praise God. Well, Father, I pray for the people. I pray for those that watch this broadcast, that you would just bless them abundantly, speak to them, take these scriptures and minister to them over and over again. And I pray that these truths would just so work in them, and that the Spirit of God would bring it to the remembrance time and time again, and that they would learn to yield to the life of God and be a partaker of it and just live in victory and go from one level of glory to the next. I pray your blessings, Father, upon your people. I love them and I appreciate them and I thank you for them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you for joining me. Appreciate it so much. Have a blessed day. We'll see you tomorrow morning at 8 a.m. as we continue our teaching on overcoming the flesh. Leanna, I love you. We'll see you tomorrow.